Take a moment and imagine this. You're a scriptwriter with big dreams of making it in the film industry, but all the positions for that career path require 5 years of experience? Where am I supposed to get that in the first place? There has to be a better way. Enter Netflix. Netflix has a powerful new initiative to hire people who have never written anything before in their life and give them the opportunity to work on creating a huge lineup of uninspired sci-fi garbage. Today, from this inspiring series of movies, I bring you The Titan.
As nuclear fallout over the Pacific continues to fuel sandstorms over Southern California, the last remaining pockets of residents were evacuated by the National Guard. The federal government, already struggling to keep up with flash floods in Long Beach and Venice, has declared Los Angeles uninhabitable.
Whoa, the movie starts out really optimistic. They think Los Angeles will last until 2048. Yeah, that's right. The year is 2048 and only just now it's declared uninhabitable. But it turns out that's the only good thing that's happened. You know, the Dow is up on this news, everyone's happy, but the rest of the world doing very poorly. You could say the rest of the world is a Los Angeles. But don't just take my word for it. Have a listen to what Dr. Trust Me on This One has to say about this.
In 15 years, half the world's population will have starved to death. Time is running out. Our children will witness the end of days. But there is one place that gives us hope. Titan. Liquid methane raining into huge oceans and lakes that we can't swim in, and an atmosphere rich in nitrogen that we can't breathe. Too cold to exist in. Fiercely hostile to life as we know it.
Oh, well, okay, science checks out. I guess that's a better choice than Earth.
Definitely the best option we're gonna have here is clearly injecting the people in this room with genetically modifying material, changing them into super mutants, and then sending them to one of the moons of Saturn. I don't really think we have another option here. Nothing else really came to the table, and the last plan was recycling. It's so hard to keep the cans and the plastic separate that,
Dr. Hernandez, I was waiting for you to object.
He really steps up for everybody here and starts to explain some things that are making a lot of sense. As it turns out, these proposed experiments are extremely deadly and carry immeasurable health risks. But before he can explain too much, the main character shuts him down real fast.
You got kids?
No.
Shut the fuck up or get the fuck out.
So they start taking all these drugs and then...
Stay with us, come on.
It's okay, it's fine, it's fine. I know what you're thinking. It's fine. She had kids.
Nobody said we was gonna die.
So everything continues as normal. They continue taking the drugs. Our boy even decides to playfully take his death serum in the butt. She rolls her eyes. He kind of has a playful smirk about the whole situation, which is weird because, you know, he never has a personality ever again. Unless you consider slightly aggressive sirloin a personality, and then boom, that's it. There's his code name. Things actually seem to be going pretty well for a while. They're throwing barbecue parties in their super mansions they've been gifted because they're gonna die soon anyway, so why not? The only hint that something might be going wrong is those really cliche, insidious black veins that grow inside people when they've been injected with something sinister. Yeah, they all have that. One of the guys hopped up on the juice, just starts freaking out and going nuts, and everyone jumps on him, and they're like, "You can't do that, bro! Go home, bro!" And he's like, "It's fine, bro, I won't do it again, bro." So he goes home and chucks his wife out the window.
This isn't space research. It's criminal and morally repugnant. They're becoming violent, losing control. You are lying to
Nobody gives a shit.
Got him. The experimentation continues uninterrupted, and now we're testing boys out in the field. And as we all know, Titan has a lot of swimming pools, so most of the tests involve them. They got swimming, they got synchronized diving, they got Houdini escape routines, they have lovemaking, and most importantly, they have staring contests. This is to prepare them for the most difficult task ahead. Yes, they will have to open their eyes underwater. No goggles, no protection. The scientists are all concerned. They know the risks. There's kids peeing in this pool. There's a sweaty man at the spa bubble thing. But Sirloin is the hero he needs to be. He pulls through and he does it anyway. He does it! He's doing it!
Okay, flush his eyes, prep him, get him into surgery now. No, Miss Jackson, you have to stay here. When we know something, we'll tell you.
Ah, jeez. Sirloin's fallen down on some tough times, but I wouldn't count him out. It's the hero's journey. You gotta get knocked down before you can get up again, and trust me, he gets back up again. Oh, yeah. He goes into the water again, opens his eyes again, persistent as ever. Legend has it, he does it so long his skin starts coming off. Legend says he keeps his eyes open so long he goes bald. And then the next time you see him, something... I can't put my finger on it, but something's changed. What does any of this have to do with Titan? Nothing. So she takes her mutant husband home for one last chance at
Alien 6
before he gets shipped off to Titan, but he's so slow and stupid he can't even put his own jacket on. So she comes over to help him, and he accidentally jabs her in the nose. It was just an accident, things happen, and she freaks out like, oh my god, you're a monster now! And he feels kind of, I guess, sad about that. I don't know, he doesn't display any more or less emotion than he used to, so it's hard to tell. And then things just start spiraling out of control. The only other person who survived these trials shows up at their house, and then they start doing a weird tendril handshake thing, and the police, they think that's a gang sign, so they show up. She starts flexing on them by doing a really weird slow walk down the stairs, and they're shooting her with tranquilizer darts, but it doesn't do anything, it just makes her armpits droop a little bit. Eventually, after enough sleep darts, she goes down, and they're crawling up to try and wrangle her, but it was just a prank, bro. She's dead, and there goes all that taxpayer money, so all we have now is Big Doofus standing there, can't even put a jacket on by himself, but can easily handle 5 armed security guards by himself. He's drowning the last guy in the swimming pool he loves so much before his wife comes out and is like,
"No!"
At which point he realizes, well, I gotta run. He doesn't make it very far, they catch him pretty easily, and his wife wakes up in the hospital, tripped down the stairs, totally unrelated, don't worry about it. The doctor is there to catch her up to speed on everything that has happened, and the whole time her face is just like she finally realized what a bad movie she's in.
Now Rick's safe, and Lucas, but we don't have any time. He's now the future, and he's going to survive if we can help him. But we need to get him on Titan so he can live. We need your help. If we force him, I fear we'll kill him. Do you understand?
No, you want to put a serial killer on a moon? Why?
If you can make him submit.
Submit to what?
If you can make him take one of these, you can end his suffering.
This is a chemical lobotomy. He'll erase all of his memories.
He's resisting.
Sadly, she agrees to lobotomize her husband. As she hands off the drug to place it inside the syringe, she drops it, and she sneakily replaces it with the saline that is in the same future tech box as their mind-destroying drug.
Quetiapine.
Treats schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and depression. Anyway, no one notices her switch it out, so that happens. She injects him with basically nothing, and then the first chance he gets...
No! No, get out!
You got kids?
It's not the first time this actor has been a soldier turned into a giant blue guy, so he's pretty good at it. He runs around killing everybody up until he finds an empty room and there's no one to kill, except his son is there, which is weird because his mom keeps bringing him to where all the murders are. Anyway, with bad parenting aside, this is the final showdown. This is it. The doctor's here, his commander, all of the soldiers pointing down to the blue monster in this final confrontation. What will they do?
It's over, Abby. It's done with. Shoot them.
What?
Shoot them!
Go fuck yourself.
I made him! But if we can't control him, all of us are dead. All of us.
Well, that's one argument you could make, I guess. He did just kill a whole bunch of soldiers, my friends, my family, my brothers, but what I'm going to do, I'm going to pull a power play and point my gun at you instead. In any second now, the hive mind of soldiers that are with me are also going to simultaneously aim at you because we've deemed you the bad guy. That's going to settle that. We don't have to listen to you anymore. So what they do instead is they listen to him and they follow through with the plan and they get this guy on a plane and they literally fly him to Titan. And then congratulations, problem solved. We don't have to worry about humanity anymore because there is one guy on Titan. I know we're all going to starve to death in 15 years, but don't worry about it. There's one sociopath just hanging out on Titan, swimming around, and he doesn't even swim because he can fly. He could fly the whole time, so what's with all the swimming pools?
What?